questions and discussion, but I'll be talking on numerous panels during the convention, some of which are even on things I know something about, and others are not. I just did an interview up in the hallway upstairs on Russia TV on a topic from the United States that, as far as I know, no U.S. media outlet would want to touch, and there was a brand new Pew poll of 30-some countries around the world where people polled found the greatest danger, the greatest threat to their existence was, can you guess?
Israel and the U.S.
The United States of America, yeah. And that this had gone up significantly in the past 4 years. And of course, this parallels a Gallup poll from 4 years ago where 65 countries were asked, what country is the greatest danger to peace in the world? And far and away, the winner was
U.S.
The U.S.
Number one?
Yeah, number one. Also, a quick announcement. One of the best columnists, writers on peace that I know of anywhere is sitting in the back of the room. Bob Kohler, Robert Kohler, raise your hand or stand up. Yeah. So 15 minutes after this is over, Bob will be leading in this same room a session on peace media and war media and how to do one and oppose the other. So stick around 15 minutes after we're done here. Our first speaker, I'll give you introductions of both of them. Our first speaker is going to be Leah Bolger. Leah Bolger serves as the chair of the Coordinating Committee of World Beyond War. She retired from the U.S. Navy at the rank of commander after 20 years of active duty service. She was elected as the first female, and as far as I know, only thus far, president of Veterans for Peace. That was in 2012. And in 2013, was selected to present the Ava Helen and Linus Pauling Memorial Peace Lecture at the Oregon State University. She is the chair of the Veterans for Peace Working Group on Drones and is the coordinator of the Drones Quilt Project, which you can see upstairs at both ends of the area with the tables in the Wiley Hall or Willie Hall. She founded the Corvallis branch of the Women's International League for Peace and Freedom, WILF, in January 2014. She is also a board member of the War Prevention Initiative. So we need to find something to keep her busy. Norman Solomon is a longtime activist and author whose books include War Made Easy, How Presidents and Pundits Keep Spinning Us to Death, also a terrific film, and Made Love Got War, Close Encounters with America's Warfare State. He is the executive director of the Institute for Public Accuracy and the co-founder coordinator of RootsAction.org, an online group that now has upwards of 1.5 million active members. RootsAction is dedicated to galvanizing people who are committed to economic fairness, equal rights, civil liberties, environmental protection, and defunding endless wars. Norman was a Bernie Sanders delegate to the 2016 Democratic National Convention and the coordinator of the Bernie Delegates Network. So without anything further from me, Leah Bolger, and then Norman Solomon.
Thank you so much. This is so exciting to have a packed room. I don't think I've never been in a standing room only audience, so this is pretty exciting. Okay, do the people want peace? That's the title of, or part of the title of this session. Do the people want peace? It seems like a no-brainer. Of course everybody wants peace. Who would say they're against peace? But, you know, Benjamin Netanyahu says he's for peace, and Obama got a Nobel Peace Prize, and we know that he didn't really carry out very peaceful policies. So it seems like an obvious question, but there are really a lot of deeper subtleties that you have to look at. Like, peace for whom? Peace just for the United States? Peace for our NATO allies and us? Peace for the whole world? Who are we talking about? And what is the cost? What would we have to spend, or how many lives would have to be lost if that's how you think we achieve peace? What is the trade-off? How do we get there? And what do we mean by peace? Is it just the absence of war? Most people don't think so. Most people think it has a lot more to do with quality of life, justice, things that keep that add to our human experience. things like schools and healthcare and roads and infrastructure and clean water. All those things lead to peace. So if we talk about, we want peace, we want the end of war, but how do we express our interest, our priority in this issue of we want peace? One way to do it would be to quantify it in economic terms about how much of our tax dollars do we want spent on war and the military. And I think this is one method that is a pretty good way to do it. There is an organization, the National Opinion Research Center, out of the University of Chicago, and they do something called the General Social Survey, and they've been doing it since 1973. It's highly regarded. It is referenced second only to the census. So it's a very important survey. And they've done this, like I said, they've done this for many, many years. And they ask the respondents they have 22 categories that are spending categories, line items, like police or environment or science, 22 of them. And they ask the people to say, I think we should spend more tax dollars on this area, the same tax dollars, or less tax dollars. So this is a way of prioritizing it, and you see where. So the number one and number two choices for the last several decades have been
military,
education and healthcare. The top by a wide margin for the last five, six decades. So. And then comes assistance to the poor, halting crime, social security, the environment, drug addiction, child care, assistance to cities, and out of the 22 categories, the military comes in at 18. And they're the first category that the people said they want to have less money spent on. All the others were the same or more. So this seems like it's quite obvious what the American people want their money spent on, and you all know very well that we spend way more than we should, way more. I don't have to tell you those statistics, I'm sure you know them. There's another poll, a Pew poll from 2012, and they gave the subjects, the respondents, this question. Should reducing the military spending be a top priority, an important priority, not too important, or should not be done? So that's top priority, important priority, not too important, or should not be done at all. So out of that question, should reducing military spending, 68%, over two-thirds of the people said either top priority or important priority. Only a third of the people said not too important or not at all. So there's another Pew poll. February of 2017, just a few months ago, and they gave the respondents two sentences that they were select which one best expresses their own personal view. The first one is, the best way to ensure peace is through military strength. The second one is, good diplomacy is the best way to ensure peace. Now, out of those two sentences, more than two-thirds of the respondents said they think diplomacy is the best way to keep us safe. So it's obvious from these highly regarded surveys that the American population wants to spend less on war, and they believe that diplomacy is the best way to peace. This is obvious. So why are we letting it happen that our money is being spent on war? Why is that we're not fighting back more on that? It seems like it's, I got ahead of myself in my notes. All right, so, Becca. Oh, we're recording this too, okay. All right, so I said, here we have the conclusion. We want less money on war, we want diplomacy. And then you look at the Trump budget. And you know, or maybe you've heard, maybe you haven't heard, that he wants to increase our military budget by 10%, which is $54 billion, And he wants to slash domestic programs to find that $54 billion. In the past, we usually just add that onto the deficit. We just add it on and we don't worry about it. But he wants to take it. He's going to be fiscally responsible and take it from stuff we already have earmarked for things like the EPA, things like NOAA, Weather Service. We know these don't match our priorities, but he says, I want the American people to know that our budget will reflect their priorities. But we disagree. It's like a complete opposite of what we want. What's more, we all agree that diplomacy is the best way. He's cutting 29% of the budget to the State Department. This is crazy. I guess he says, we don't want to talk to him, we want to bomb. Almost a third of the State Department's budget gone. And humanitarian aid, which right now only takes up less than 1% of our budget, he wants to slash that, humanitarian aid overseas. So it's exactly the opposite of what the people want, at least by the polls that we're responding to. So now the question is, why are we letting this happen? How has this gotten so out of control that we are inured to war, perpetual war? We think that's the way it should be. We're number one. We have to fight to keep the, you know, we have to be the policemen of the world, and this is the way it's been, that we've always been involved. And what's more, the budget, even though it's enormous, is sacrosanct. We never talk about cutting into the budget. And, you know, the pundits on television are talking about how we're going to pay for this or that. They talk about cutting into Medicare. We're going to have to take it out of Social Security. They never, ever, ever say, let's just cut the defense budget. Defense in quotation marks. Let's just cut the military budget. No, but it's not even talked about. This, I don't understand that, but it's never talked about. So I don't know if it's because the American public is so used to having troops deployed and being on one side against our enemies, our quote enemies. It's just that we're used to that. Or maybe we don't even know. I was in a community seminar talking group where we were talking about building a peace center in our town. And we were going around the center, around the room, talking about why don't we have more involvement in the anti-war movement and peace movement? Why are especially young people not involved? And this one 20-something-year-old said, well, it's really hard to get excited about peace movement when we're not at war. And my jaw drops. I said, what do you think? You don't think we're at war? And so maybe he's not curious enough, but I'm afraid that a lot of the American public are like this young man. They don't see it on their televisions. They don't read it in the papers. If they follow the mainstream news, they're not knowing. They don't know what's going on. And most people have no idea how much of our budget is spent that way either anyway, so they're not going to fight back on that. Afghanistan, 16 years we've been in there. And when's the last time you saw a report from Afghanistan? Which was the last time you talked about drone killings in Afghanistan? You don't see it. So it seems like to me that the American public only prioritize war and military stuff. It's only on their minds as a top priority when we have boots on the ground, when American soldiers are dying. And that's why Congress is so opposed to boots on the ground. This is why Congress will not sign an authorization for the use of military force, because they don't want to be on record for being responsible for a bad military, a horrible situation. So now we have drones, and the military loves drones because they kill people and no American dies. And these are the wave of the future. This is what all the military people talk about. This is what we're going to be using in the future. So this is another way that the American public is not going to know what's going on. If you see the Drone School project in there, each block is the name of someone who was killed by an American combat drone, a missile launched from a Predator or Reaper. And these names of these people I get them from the Bureau of Investigative Journalism, because the United States has no idea who they're killing. No idea. So if we don't even know who we're killing overseas, we certainly don't, the American public is not aware of that. It's never talked about. So this is how they're able to keep perpetuating war and military, even though some people do respond. They want to keep on going. So here's an example. In 2008, when Obama was running for office, he was elected in large part by anti-war groups who thought he would put an end to the Iraq War, thought he would bring everybody home. And after he was elected, the anti-war movement kind of sat back and said, "Oh, good, we don't have to do anything anymore." And even though Obama turned out to be anything but a peace president, and he won the Nobel Peace Prize, which made that award almost meaningless, even though we elected him with that thought, and he didn't really follow through, the peace movement just kind of sat back and said, you know, throw their hands up. So, in the more and more time that went by, that, you know, we weren't bringing troops home, and in fact, Obama doubled down in Afghanistan and added 40,000 troops. People just, I don't know if they've gotten tired or they just don't want to think about it anymore, but the interest has waned. And if you're a peace activist, I'm sure you've seen this too. So there is also an idea, a democratic way of thinking about whether or not we should go to war, and that is the idea of a people's referendum. Let the people decide if this is something we want to do. And back actually before World War I, the period of neutrality before World War I, before we entered it, there were several members of Congress that believed that the public should have a say in whether issues of importance to the country. And 18 years later, Ludlow, you've probably heard of the Ludlow Amendment, there was a Gallup poll in September of 1935 that showed that 75% of the Americans supported an amendment introduced by Lewis Ludlow, which said, "No war of aggression shall be waged by the Army or Navy of the United States except upon a declaration of war by the Congress of the United States, ratified and approved by a majority vote of the majority of legal votes cast upon the question in a majority of the congressional districts of the United States." It's a little confusing, but basically he's saying American people vote. And whoever wins, we go to war, we don't go to war. But he felt like this was so important that if the people voted, they would vote no. They would say no, we don't want to go to war. And that we would be this amendment would save thousands of lives. This is what he believed. Furthermore, he thought that if the United States had such an anti-war provision in our Constitution, that other countries would follow our example and believe that wars would be brought to an end. This is his belief, very pie in the sky, but that's what he thought. It's a really interesting and hopeful idea, but we will never know if it would have worked because it was voted down by a vote of 209 to 188 in 1938. I think there are a lot of reasons why, even if it were enacted, why it wouldn't work practically, and maybe we can talk about that later, but that's the end of my remarks for now, and next up.
Thank you. Norman Solomon.
You probably have noticed, to put it mildly, that the last 6 or 8 months have included a bit of turmoil politically, including where people seem to be at. You know, we've had a somewhat simplistic left-right continuum. A lot of that's been scrambled, including perceptions of where people are at in terms of war and peace. And I think of something that some musicians have said over the years. You may feel like you're getting lost, but you won't if you know the blues. And in this world of tremendous dangers and prevarications, we may feel we're getting lost just by looking at the news coverage every day. But I think we'll feel that less so if we keep centered on what our core beliefs really are and what endures through all the storms of propaganda and public events what is at the center of our values and our commitments. And to say that there are a few precepts that really are sort of central guidelines, I believe, and certainly very important to me, such as a single standard of human rights. You know, when you look at some of the factionalism around Syria, for instance, among peace groups and individuals, all very sincere, or mostly sincere. Ed Herman says there's no such thing as a sincerometer, but I assume sincerity. But if there's a single standard of human rights, then we don't believe in political repression. We don't believe in bombing people. We don't believe that taking people's lives is an appropriate way to resolve differences. We hear sometimes, well, you're just preaching to the choir. I don't know about preaching, but choirs can always learn how to sing better. If our choirs get stronger, we'll have more fortitude. I think there's no doubt that people in this room can change substantially the events in the future as we go back to our own communities. One of the great concerns that I have, especially these days, and I know many other people share this, is that the conceit that we sometimes have that as anti-war activists, as progressives, whatever our self-defined terms are, we're more or less impervious to mass media messaging, if you will, corporate propaganda. And one of the takeaways to me in the last 8 months or so is that, alas, that's not true. And I can't tell you the number of emails I've gotten from people who explain to me that they're peace activists, and they're furious at Russia and feel that we must confront Russia. And that didn't, you know, come out of a hat, and it didn't just happen by happenstance. We live within a propaganda grid, and we're not insulated from that grid. And there's nothing new under the sun, and yet it's fresh all the time, and it's fresh right now with a vengeance. You can go back to Philip Knightley's classic book, published so long ago, called The First Casualty, where he can take us back to the 19th century and the ways in which war propaganda has been effective in beating the drums to get people on board who ostensibly, right before that, might not be on board with war at all, might be quite the contrary. I think our solutions don't involve being holier than thou to anybody, but to try to enliven and deconstruct the ways in which empathy is not just caring for people who are blown up, although that's crucial, but seeing the world through other eyes. That the world, this is a radical thought, the world, the solar system and world universe does not revolve around the United States of America. Other people have perspectives that are just as valid. And so in the case of Russia, the expansion of NATO gets almost no mention in U.S. mass media. And so it's almost like a non-event. And it's not, unfortunately, even brought up that much in discourse among progressives and anti-war folks in trying to understand where the United States and Russia have a difference of perspective. And so the other kind of empathy of seeing the world through other eyes is just absolutely crucial. Otherwise, we're, you know, marching off on another holy crusade, reluctantly, albeit soldiering on, and brandishing the worst weapons humanity has, or inhumanity has ever been able to create. Howard Zinn said that there is no such thing as a just war, but there are just causes. And I think that's, at least for me, I think for some other people, it's been a useful distinction to clarify as we talk about the struggles for independence, for freedom, for justice, for freedom to live without fear in international relations, and that there are inside countries and within and between countries, there are just causes. But there are no just wars. And a just war is an oxymoron. As Leah referred to, we've got polls showing the vast majority, I think she said more than two-thirds of the public in this country preferring diplomacy, you know, really wanting diplomacy. And yet when we hit that hard wall of propaganda, as we're hitting right now, particularly in terms of Russia, but as well in terms of Iran, in terms of North Korea, this absolute refusal to see the world through other eyes, but insist that the most defining way to understand the world is looking through the lenses that are tinted red, white, and blue. These are challenges that we as activists, I think, have not only in our own society as a whole, but even within many we've worked with for years and decades, many of the media outlets that we rely on as progressive are split. The vote that took place for sanctions against Russia is ironically sort of Soviet style. How do you get a vote where every Democrat and almost all but three Republicans in the House of Representatives vote for sanctions? How does that happen? What kind of lockstep are we in? And I think that helps point up to us the difference in role between being an activist and being evidently the best congressperson that reality has been able to imagine right now. It's our responsibility, it's our capacity to say what's sometimes literally unsayable by those we venerate the most. Think about the congressperson you venerate the most right now. I guarantee you that person is incapable, especially if they've got a D after their name, a Democrat after their name. I guarantee you that person's incapable, at least so far, of saying publicly that the momentum to denounce Russia must be reversed. You just can't hear people say that. The best they can do in Congress is to keep their mouth shut on that topic. And it reminds me, for instance, a number of years ago, David and I at Roots Action worked on a petition for Palestinian rights. And we sent it around to people on Capitol Hill. And I got a great response from somebody, a staffer there, one of the best staffers on Capitol Hill. And he said, that's a terrific petition. There's not one member of the House or Senate who would sign it. And I think that's just a reflection, again, not to just overly discourage ourselves, but we need to be willing to say that the empire has no clothes. We need to be able to mobilize to change the discourse, because at first, and you name the topic, whether it's gay marriage or anything else, all the progress we've been able to achieve collectively has first come from people who looked at, came up with a scenario that is just, is imperative in human terms, knew that it was off the grid in terms of being considered by mass media or on Capitol Hill to be within the realm of remote possibility, and then just went at it. So when we look at the crises right now, and it's reflected, I think, in the sanctions bill that was just signed evidently by Trump, you know, that just sailed through Congress. We look at the war drums that are beating really towards Russia, towards Iran, towards North Korea. Then we have an opportunity which might seem, and maybe in some ways is, a desperate opportunity, but it's a necessity to strengthen our own choir, to reach out, to find different ways to communicate to the broader public. Often it's, I think, much more difficult to challenge our political adversaries than to challenge our friends. The hardest articles I've ever written have been the ones that take to task those I most admire in Congress or elsewhere. I think that's going to be absolutely essential for us as organizers, as activists, as writers, as speakers, as agitators, as lobbyists, to say to those who often represent, quote unquote, the most progressive districts in this country, to say that it's not acceptable for you to be on the war bandwagon. And I think that whether they will acknowledge it or not, it's fair to say that the vast majority of members of Congress, through their silence or their statements, they are on a war bandwagon, including towards Russia. And we hear a lot about, and I think it's quite true, that we must denounce climate change denial. The Republican Party, it's bastion total almost, climate change denial. The nuclear war denial is entirely bipartisan. And as a matter of fact, I would say that the Democrats in Congress are, whether consciously or not, engaged in some of the most dangerous nuclear Holocaust denial that one can imagine. And when you look at the logical, or at least predictable, plausible results of the war frenzy that has been lifted up by mass media and primarily Democrats in Congress against Russia, and then just extrapolate, I think I'll close on this note. Where does that really lead? You know, plausibly, where does that lead? You know, we condemn the CEOs who think only the next few quarters. They're dumping the poisons into the river, but they're thinking the next few quarters of profits. Well, what about these members of Congress who are dumping the poisons of polarization and demonization and de facto war propaganda into the body politic bloodstream? What about those folks? And why are we so inclined to give them a pass? There was a piece of the New York Times just a couple of days ago, and buried way down near the bottom, it was a David Sanger article, and most of it was the usual run-of-the-mill, whip-up-the jingoism kind of coverage, but very towards the end, there was one paragraph that said that with the partial exception of Syria, where there's some intermittent communication, there's essentially no military-to-military communication between the Russian and U.S. militaries. Something that even at the height of the Cold War was going on. But now, virtually all that is swept away. And so I think among the questions, the pointed questions that we need to ask of those who tell us that they are progressive members of Congress and any member of Congress is that what you want? You want no communication between these governments? And then what? And then what? And then what? Thank you.